Coming in at number 5, we have Six Flags New Orleans. Six Flags is a 140-acre abandoned theme park in New Orleans. It first opened in 2000, but has been closed since it was seriously damaged by flooding during Hurricane Katrina on August 29, 2005. Despite various proposals to redevelop the site, it has remained abandoned, overgrown with plants, infested with wildlife, and in poor condition. Trespassing is prohibited, yet videos and photos of the site keep surfacing over the years from urban explorers and thrill seekers. As a result, city officials have become more diligent in securing the park and banning tours. As of today, there is still a creepy sign at the park entrance which reads, "Closed for the storm." The site remains abandoned and is the perfect location for a movie set, with movies like Jurassic Park and Dawn of the Planet of the Apes using it as their backdrop. Coming in at number 4, we have Pripyat Amusement Park, Chernobyl, Ukraine. The Pripyat Amusement Park is an abandoned park located in Pripyat, Ukraine. It was to be opened for the first time on May 1st, 1986, in time for the May Day celebrations. But these plans were cancelled on April 26, when the Chernobyl nuclear disaster occurred a few kilometers away. Constructed under the Soviet Union, the amusement park includes 5 attractions: the iconic Ferris wheel, bumper cars, paratrooper ride, and a carnival shooting game. The park was briefly accessible to locals, but they were forced to evacuate as reports of dangerously high levels of radiation in the area started to emerge. Theories that the park hurriedly opened in the aftermath of the accident distract Pripyat residents from the unfolding disaster seem to be substantiated by the fact that some of the rides were never fully completed. In any case, the park, particularly the Ferris wheel, have become a new symbol for the Chernobyl disaster. Radiation levels around the park vary. The liquidators washed radiation into the soil after the helicopters carrying radioactive materials used the grounds as a landing strip, so concrete areas are relatively safe. However, areas where moss has built up are among the highest levels of radiation in the whole of Pripyat. Today, the park remains untouched, and with the unused rise gradually disintegrating and being consumed by mold.
Number 3, Joyland Depths. Located in Wichita, Kansas, Joyland once featured state-of-the-art rides and attractions, holding a reign of 55 years of fun and joy. Today, the once popular park is being reclaimed by nature. Piece by piece by piece. So Joyland came into existence on June 12th of 1949. It was founded by Lester Ottaway and his sons, Herbert and Harold. Herb Ottaway had a passion for steam engines and race cars, and he refurbished both types of vehicles. By 1934, Herb had refurbished a miniature steam locomotive and cars and was traveling with them to county fairs in Kansas and Colorado. Joyland was opened to give Herb's refurbished locomotive a more permanent home. As the attraction became more popular, the Ottaways eventually added a number of different rides and games to the amusement park. Lester Ottaway passed away in the mid-1950s, and his sons continued running Joyland until the early 1970s, when they decided to retire. Joyland was then sold to Stanley and Margaret Nelson, who owned the park until it closed its doors in 2004. Joyland featured attractions such as a wooden roller coaster, which I love, a wacky shacky dark ride, a log jam, a sky coaster, bumper cars, a carousel, and a Ferris wheel. On April 6th of 2004, a 13-year-old girl was enjoying a Ferris wheel ride with her friends when the restraint bar holding them in came undone. The young girl fell more than 30 feet, suffering multiple head, arm, and leg injuries. The Ferris wheel was immediately closed while both private and federal investigators looked into whether everything was safe and up to code. The ride was later reopened after these investigations were wrapped up. Also, another notable ride at Joyland was the wooden roller coaster that was known as the Nightmare. Although the roller coaster was a staple at the amusement park, it too saw its fair share of injuries, which is a shame. Like, I really, really, really love wooden coasters. On May 25th of 1977, somebody in the single digits of age stood up in one of the carts and fell, died at the scene from the injuries sustained from the fall. Another death occurred 20 years later, on August 27th of 1998, when 35-year-old maintenance worker Kevin Briley was under the ride trimming the grass. He stood up and was tragically hit by the coaster and passed away. My heart hurts telling that tale because, like I said already, I'm such a huge lover of traditional wooden roller coasters. You know, there's just something about narrowly avoiding whiplash that I personally find thrilling. And go figure, Joyland closed its doors in 2004. Number 2, doomed before it could open. The Pripyat Amusement Park was set to have its grand opening on May 1st of 1986. In time for the May Day celebrations, but these plans were cancelled on April 26 when the Chernobyl disaster occurred, you know, just a couple of kilometers away. Several sources report that the park was opened for a short time on April 27th before the announcement to evacuate the city was made to distract, you know, residents from the unfolding disaster nearby. Constructed under the Soviet Union as a park of culture and rest, typical of many large cities in the then Soviet Union, the amusement park's attractions were manufactured by the Yeskik-based firm Attraction, who were responsible for the construction of many of the amusement parks which remain to be seen around the former Soviet Union today in various states of repair. Located northwest to the Palace of Culture in the center of Pripyat, the park had five attractions. The iconic 26-meter Ferris wheel titled Circular Overview, Autodrome bumper cars, a paratrooper ride called Chamomile, Russian swing boats, and also a carnival pew-pew game. Fun fact, the successor to the original company is still manufacturing the Ferris wheel, paratrooper, and bumper cars to the similar designs as of 2017. Radiation levels around the park kind of vary though. The liquidators washed radiation into the soil after the helicopters carrying radioactive materials used the grounds as a landing strip, so concrete areas are less radioactive. However, areas where moss is built up can emit levels amongst the highest levels of radiation in the whole of Pripyat. So the Ferris wheel actually made news in September of 2017 when Polish tourists turned it mechanically for the first time since 1986. Thankfully, they returned it back to its original position, but kind of neat that it could still work. Number 1. A cursed history. Lake Shawnee Amusement Park opened its doors in 1926 when proprietor Conley Snedow Sr. purchased the land. His vision to build a place for local families to relax and enjoy time together was realized as the coal miners from local towns descended on it each year, making it a fantastic destination for summer vacations. The park was full of activities. It featured a man-made swimming lake, a racetrack, concessions, and cabins for visitors, looking for an overnight stay. The big cornerstones were the Ferris wheel and the swings, two rides that were popular with everyone who spent time at the park. And you know what? That all sounds pretty idyllic to me. Tragedy, though, began to grip the amusement park in the 1950s, when several deaths shocked locals. A young girl's life ended on the swing ride when a delivery truck backed into her seat, killing her in place. Another youngster lost his life when he drowned in the swimming pool after his arm got stuck in a drain pipe. And by 1966, this amusement park closed its doors to the public, and the land sat dormant for decades. In the 1980s, the park again welcomed visitors when Gaylord White acquired the land and set out to restore it to its former glory. In addition to purchasing a Ferris wheel, he found a swing ride that seemed just like the swings that once thrilled guests. Now, fun fact, when they installed the swings on the property, they realized the swings weren't just similar. They were the exact same swings from years prior, something that they decided to advertise during the grand reopening. The Lake Shawnee Amusement Park welcomed tens of thousands of visitors during its second run, which ran for just 3 years in the 1980s. Unfortunately, high insurance prices forced the White family to close their doors for the second and final time after those couple of short seasons, forcing them to pivot to other activities to keep the land active. They hosted fishing tournaments in what used to be the swimming lake, and they planned to create a space on the property for mud bogging, a motorsport the family knew would draw crowds to watch. While excavating a mud bogging track, the White family made a series of surprising discoveries that added depth to the property's history. For starters, the park was built over a Native American burial ground, with an archaeological dig uncovering 13 bodies, mostly young folks. In the 1700s, the property was the active home base for the Native Americans until they seemed to suddenly disappear. Among the bracelets, clothing, and tools that excavators found, they also found mass graves that suggested as many as 30,000 people had been buried on the property. But that's not the darkest history of the land. In 1783, Mitchell Clay was the first European settler to make a home in the area, which was heavily inhabited by the Shawnee Native American tribe. So while Clay was gone to town one day, the Shawnee surrounded three of the Clay descendants who were working in the fields. Bartley met his end first, and Tabitha, hearing the explosion, ran to her brother, where she was attacked and cut by a stabby implement. Her body was dismembered, and both of their scalps were taken by the entire group. Their brother Ezekiel was captured and burned at the stake. A historical marker on the road leading to the park commemorates their memories. One could wonder if the tragic history of the grounds is the reason for these six deaths that occurred at the park, eventually leading to it being closed down in 1966. And many locals, including the park's new owner, claim the park to still be haunted. Kicking us off in fifth place, we have water park troubles. This tale takes place at Schlitterbahn, which is a theme park owned by Cedar Fair in Texas on the Raging Rapids portion of the Lazy River. Our narrator Vanessa and her friends didn't expect anything intense from the ride. They were all just, looking forward to relaxing, watching the water go by, enjoying the scenery. As expected, the ride wasn't super intense whatsoever at first, until it hit a patch of white water, and because of the angle that the raft hit the bump, Vanessa and her companions were launched into the river. Nope, that's not supposed to be part of the ride. Mm-mm. And while the ride might have only been, 3 feet or so deep of water, I'm reminded of all the posters from my local pool growing up about how people can literally drown in a bathtub. So, yikes. Vanessa described herself as entering a state of shock, feeling emotions ranging from fright to embarrassment, confusion, and panic. As she attempted to reach for the raft to pull herself back in, she realized she couldn't see her friends anywhere, and she was once again being yanked underwater. Panic had taken over as the main emotion by this point, and Vanessa found herself swirling around and around and around under the water. Thankfully, a nearby lifeguard jumped into action and was able to hoist Vanessa and her friends back into their raft, allowing them to enjoy the rest of the rapids in the intended fashion. I'm a little concerned about the lack of seatbelts on that ride, since they were never mentioned, and I feel like that should be a thing, or like a weight sensor to stop the ride in event that, you know, someone goes over. Oh, just me, okay. As a high point to this, somehow Vanessa managed to keep her glasses on throughout the entire ordeal. Go Vanessa! In fourth place, we have an urban legend from Canada's Wonderland. Time to move on to a Cedar Fair park that's a little closer to home. As someone who spends most of September through December at Canada's Wonderland every year, I just knew I had to include this ghost story in today's list. While Wonderland might be home to the scariest of scary monsters every October, the iconic Wonder Mountain is actually home to a ghostly spirit all year round. Construction of the iconic theme park happened between 1979 until 1981, with construction of the mountain alone involving a dozen local companies under Cincinnati engineer Curtis D. Summers. Now, while we don't know the name of our victim, one of the construction workers who was working on Wonder Mountain passed on the job, and for the most part, the details of his passing and specifics have been kept pretty secret. I tried. I promise I tried. This ghostie haunts the mountain to this day, specifically the Thunder Run ride. If the ride operators don't greet the area with good morning and good night at the beginning and the end of each operating day, the ride will malfunction and cease operations until given the proper respect. Honestly, I'm all for inviting the ghost to roam the park during Halloween haunt. What's the worst that could happen? An actual ghost over in Ghostly Pines or Spirit Manor would be so much fun to see. Oh, just my own opinion again? Of course.
Coming in at number 3, Gulliver's Kingdom, Yamanashi, Japan. This surreal amusement park was based on the novel Gulliver's Travels by Jonathan Swift. At the center of the sprawling park lay a giant model of the novel's titular character, Lemuel Gulliver, tied to the ground. The park has a beautiful view of Mount Fuji, however sadly due to low visitor numbers, the park only lasted 4 years before being closed down. Luckily for us though, photographer Martin Lyle explored the park's interior, stating, "The giant Gulliver was unreal. Entering the grounds, I didn't see him right away. Then as I delved deeper into the park, he suddenly loomed out of the landscape. It was such a momentous thing to stand in the presence of. It was the most amazing and surreal object I've ever seen. It felt so weird to lie in the palm of a giant man while surrounded by the stunning scenery." Coming in at number 2, Land of Oz, North Carolina. The Land of Oz is a theme park in the resort town of Beach Mountain, North Carolina. In 1970, it opened as a theme park based on the L. Frank Baum Wizard of Oz book by Caroline Caribbean Corporation. Based on the L. Frank Baum Wizard of Oz books by Caroline Caribbean Corporation under the guidance of Grover Robbins, who had been successful with Tweetsie's Railroad and designed by Jack Pentes. On Sunday, December 28, 1975, a fire was set to the Emerald City Amphitheater. On Sunday, December 28, 1975, a fire was set to the Emerald City Amphitheater and surrounding gift shops. Two buildings were destroyed along with the park's offices, costumes, sound equipment, and props. There is some speculation that the fires were set by disgruntled employees. Now it would go on to be rebuilt and managed by a new company, however, it would never recover with the park officially closing in 1980. Urban explorers often visit the park, taking pictures and sometimes even stealing pieces of the yellow brick road. Land of Oz still opens its gates a few days a year around Halloween for visitors brave enough to explore. And finally, coming at number 1, Dunblobbin Crinkly Bottom Theme Park, England. Crinkly Bottom, also popularly referred to as Blobbyland, was the operating title for a series of British theme parks operating in the 1990s. They were created by Noel Edmonds, based on the fictional village of Crinkly Bottom, where the Noel's House Party TV series was based. Three parks were operated under the Crinkly Bottom name in England by Edmonds' company, however all the parks eventually failed and were either closed or rebranded. The first park located in Cricket St. Thomas was based around the existing wildlife park in the Cricket House Country Estate. The Crinkly Bottom Park was based around Mr. Blobby, with a Blobby-themed house called Dunblobbin being the main attraction. The park opened back in 1994 and was popular for a while. However, a couple years later, Edmonds pulled out of backing the park, with it being rebranded to Cricket St. Thomas Wildlife Park, and Dunblobbin being closed and sealed off. off. In the 2000s, urban explorers rediscovered the abandoned Dunblobbin House, which of course led to more people returning to Cricket St. Thomas to see it. Today, there are a ton of rumors that the site is haunted, and ghost hunters often visit in hopes of catching something supernatural.
Number 5 on this list is Atlantis Marine Park. We are headed all the way down under for this one because Atlantis Marine Park is actually in Australia. AustralianNews.com writes, Atlantis Marine Park was initially a huge success with families from WA and beyond flocking to the park to watch the live dolphin shows, swim in the pools, ride pedal boats, and have their obligatory photo with King Neptune, a huge statue at the entrance to the park. However, in 1990, just 9 years after opening, Atlantis shut its doors. Western Australia's boom never eventuated, and the 1987 stock market crash put a halt to prosperity. Atlantis closed due to financial difficulty and was left abandoned. It has since been damaged by vandals and has become overgrown and derelict. Old statues can still be found scattered throughout the grounds, as well as broken walls and concrete pools. For years, it was no man's land, popular with dog walkers. However, just last month, the iconic King Neptune was restored to his former glory after a petition by locals who started an online campaign for something to be done with the ruins. Well, I'm glad to see that Neptune is looking fresh again, but I don't know how long he'll stay that way. Apparently, this place, when the sun goes down, is home to some evil creatures. Four-legged mutant things with glowing red eyes that hiss and are nothing that we know of from this world. Now, this could be a bunch of baloney, but that's what some people have reported seeing when they've explored this place at night. Probably safe to go during the daytime, just make sure you set an alarm for 6 p.m. to get out of there if you do go. Number 4 on this list is Crinkly Bottom Theme Park. This one, to my understanding, has been demolished, but it still deserves a spot on this list because of how creepy it was when it was around. Mr. Blobby was a TV caricature in the early 1990s. He was featured on one of Britain's most successful late-night Saturday television shows and was this big pink blob creature with a bow tie on. This was a comedy television show, and this blob thing didn't lack any of that. He would often engage in annoying antics with celebrity guests and become a bit of a British television phenomenon. Well, Mr. Blobby was successful enough that he of course needed toys, merchandise, and heck, while we're at it, let's give him his own amusement park. Sometimes what works well on TV doesn't always translate to a fun amusement park though. Crinkly Bottom was what they called it, and it opened up in 1994. This annoying sidekick's popularity didn't last forever though, and this amusement park's life was very short-lived. The place shut down in 1996 because it simply was not making enough money. Then it faded away into obscurity and everybody forgot about this interesting little business venture. That was until 2009 though, when some urban explorers stumbled upon it again. The once bright and beautiful Blobby Land looked like something straight out of a horror film. It was worn and gross and just reeked of evil. Animals had taken up residence there, and based on how the place looked, it wouldn't have been surprising if some sketchy characters once did business there too. You can't visit it now because it's demolished, but you really shouldn't have been going when it was around anyways.
In third place, we have the Warner Brothers Jungle Habitat. Originally opening on July 19th of 1972, this now abandoned park closed its doors by 1976, which is a really bad timeline for a theme park that was technically never completed. The first time Jungle Habitat made headlines was only months after it first opened for business, when an Israeli tourist named Abraham Levy was riding through the safari in a taxicab and decided to roll down the window to get a better look at some of the animals roaming around. Two lions attacked the car and mauled the 26-year-old tourist, causing lacerations to his face and shoulder. He took credit for the harm, citing his own foolishness, which helped to dodge, I guess, like a media onslaught. For the most part. By the end of the year, reports of animals escaping into the wild of West Milford, which is where the park is located, were far too many in volume to be ignored. Besides the sightings of harmless animals like peacocks, there were numerous rumors spreading about dangerous animals such as like a pack of wolves and a lion being sighted along like local roads. Okay, look, I grew up in the land of moose, and I wouldn't want to see one of those on the side of the highway. I can't imagine seeing a lion on the side of one. These sentiments voiced way back in the day are identical to the rumors still running rampant today. Tales told by local residents who have, you know, like looked out into their backyards include wandering ostriches and a band of baboons running amok in the town's pharmacy. Guess they needed a prescription filled. Emus, baboons, and even wolves are just some of the uncaged critters which have been known to actually have escaped the park. I feel like I found the origins for the Night at the Museum franchise. On July 8th of 1974, a 68-year-old visitor from Long Island was grabbed by the trunk of a baby elephant, which then slammed her against a fence and bit her. The woman, her name's Elizabeth Ennis, by the way, was later awarded $200,000 by a court. In an account in the New York Times, she claimed the elephant bit her on the right hand, and because of the trauma incurred by being slammed into the fence, she had persistent pain in her right side that prevented her from lifting heavy items. Her husband was awarded $5,000 for the loss of companionship. I'm just glad that's all that she went through. Goodness, elephants are pretty big. The animals also had a tendency to damage the cars that passed through. An e-museum for the park that exists online now says that the tigers like to bite and pop car tires, and monkeys like to rip antennas off the cars. Sounds like a lack of good animal training and boundaries to me, but I'm no animal expert. Right after the park closed in October of 1976, some of the animal carcasses were left outside. This pile grew until, 30 animal bodies, including that of an elephant, a bison, a camel, and some zebras, were all left lying until April, when the ground had thawed enough to finally bury what was left of them. The 6 months that they were left exposed was a violation of state laws, which stated that any animal should be buried within 48 hours of its passing. Despite this violation, Warner Brothers were not sanctioned. Jungle habitat is gone now, but never forgotten. Reports of mysterious kangaroo sightings in remote corners of West Milford still turn up from time to time. Be careful, kangaroos hurt. In second place, we have the Joyland deaths. Located in Wichita, Kansas, Joyland once featured state-of-the-art rides and attractions, holding a reign of 55 years of fun and joy. Today, the once popular park is being reclaimed by nature, piece by piece by piece by piece. Joyland came into existence on June 12th of 1949. It was founded by Lester Ottaway and his sons, Herbert and Harold. Now, Herb had a passion for steam engines and race cars, and he refurbished both types of vehicles. By 1934, Herb Ottaway had refurbished a miniature steam locomotive and cars, and was traveling with them to county fairs in Kansas and Colorado. Joyland was originally opened to give Herb's refurbished locomotive a more permanent home. As the attraction became more popular, the Ottaways eventually added a number of different rides and games to the amusement park. Now, Lester Ottaway passed away in the mid-1950s, but his sons continued running Joyland until the early 1970s, when they decided to, retire. Joyland was then sold to Stanley and Margaret Nelson, who owned the park until it closed its doors in 2004. Joyland featured attractions such as a wooden roller coaster, my personal favorite kind of coaster, a wacky shack dark ride, a log jam, a sky coaster, bumper cars, the classic carousel, and of course, a Ferris wheel. Now on April 6th of 2004, a 13-year-old girl was enjoying a Ferris wheel ride with her friends when the restraint bar holding them in came undone. The young girl fell more than 30 feet, suffering multiple head, arm and leg injuries, and it's a miracle that she survived. The Ferris wheel was immediately closed, while both private and federal investigations looked into whether everything was, safe and up to code. The ride managed to, reopen eventually after these investigations were wrapped up, so okay, I wonder what to code means anymore. Another notable ride at Joyland was the wooden roller coaster that was known as the Nightmare. Although the roller coaster was a staple at the amusement park, it too saw its fair share of injuries. On May 25th of 1977, one rider stood up in one of these carts and fell. He passed at the scene from injuries sustained from the fall. Another death occurred 20 years later on August 27th of 1998 when a 35-year-old maintenance worker named Kevin Briley was under the ride trimming the grass. He stood up and was tragically hit by the roller coaster. He also died at the scene from his injuries. My heart hurts telling that tale because I'm such a huge lover of traditional wooden roller coasters. There's just something about narrowly avoiding whiplash that I personally find thrilling. Joyland closed its doors in 2004. Maybe it might be worth, a little urban exploration. In first place, time to visit the ghosts of the Enchanted Forest. The whimsical 20-acre amusement park was built in an Oregon forest and boasted handcrafted attractions like Storybook Lane and Toftville Western Town, along with rides like the Ice Cream Mountain Bobsled Roller Coaster and a Big Timber Log Ride. Sounds pretty magical, right? Yeah, that all depends on who you ask. Though many folks experience nothing more than a charming park, other more abnormal experiences are definitely not in line with a regular amusement park. For many, a visit to the Enchanted Forest can be a supernatural phenomenon, and I know I'd be happy either way. I love all things fantastical and wonderful and whimsical, but also spooky. Tales of employees feeling a ghostly presence on attractions like the Haunted House and Challenge of Mondor ride caught my eye while doing research for today. The story of Enchanted Forest starts with Roger Toft, the park's creator, who spent every last penny he had to make his passion project come to life in 1971. His granddaughter, Ashley Toft, is now the park's general manager, and while she claims she's personally never experienced any supernatural phenomena on the Haunted House, she did admit that the attraction makes her feel feel anxious and overwhelmed. While guiding a group of experienced paranormal experts through the attraction, she led them directly to a cold spot that could be attributed to an otherworldly presence. As much as I understand the stigma of not wanting to believe in ghosts, that's a coincidence I can't just like ignore. Challenge of Mondor ride operator Chris Dunn has since told a tale of an inexplicable encounter that he experienced one morning in 2016 while prepping the wizard-themed target aiming attraction for the day. He explained how he heard footsteps behind him, but turned around. No one there. Mere seconds after hearing the footsteps, he described being hit with a strange energy throughout his body, one that made him dizzy and gave him a horrible case of chills. Now later in the day, the same thing happened, but with more intensity. He took photos of the ride not in operation and captured images of what looks to be an orb that changes shapes in three sequential photos. The team of investigators I mentioned before were granted permission to spend a night unsupervised at the park and experience the chilling energy and the challenge of Mondor, and managed to communicate with a spirit in the haunted house. Notice how I haven't mentioned like a park tragedy yet as the cause for anything? That's because, unlike the other places on this list, there wasn't one. The haunted house was built during the original construction along with the rest of attractions, and Challenge of Mondor was constructed in 2006. Time to borrow that time machine I've been asking the powers that be for and travel on back. In August of 1846, Oregon settlers and indigenous tribes of the Willamette Valley fought a terrible battle in present-day Salem known as Battle Creek. The theory most people believe is that the energy could be the cause of the manifestation in the theme park, which was built in close proximity to the gruesome fight. You let me know what you think down in the comments.
Number 5 on this list is the shaky infrastructure. Whenever we go to theme parks, we all buy into the fact that these are safe. We believe in the infrastructure that they are and are led to think that these rides and these attractions are regularly monitored by safety inspectors and need to meet certain standards if they are to be ridden. Disneyland prides itself with being one of the safest parks in the world and is always talking about how they check the rides like crazy. That might just be a complete bunch of baloney though. A former employee of the Disney parks recently exposed them for doing something super sketchy with one of their rides. Andrew379 says, used to work at Splash Mountain and one time the ceiling collapsed on the logs with guests in it. They just put a tarp over the hole and kept running the ride. I never rode it again after that. Now, I'm no expert on safety precautions, but you would have to imagine that tossing a tarp over a gaping hole probably isn't gonna fit the bill. Now, I don't think that anyone went on to get injured while riding this ride afterwards, so that's a positive, but it definitely calls some things into question. Like, now that I know Disney does stuff like this, you gotta wonder about all the other rides they have at their parks. How many times throughout the history of Disneyland did they have a ride run when it probably shouldn't have been? Were there any borderline times where they should have just let the ride be and pushed it too far? How many times do they cover up little things like this? All important and pertinent questions if you ever want to see me riding another Disneyland ride ever again. Number 4 on this list is Walt's Light. Walt Disney was a very sentimental guy. He liked little mementos and cute little things. Well, one of those little things that he did was have a lamp that was always turned on when he was at work. Disney Wiki says, according to legend, when Walt created an apartment in Disneyland, he placed furniture with a small kitchen and a lamp. The lamp was used as a signal for the Disneyland cast members. Every time Walt went to work, he would turn the lamp on. When Walt went home, he would turn it off. When Walt died, the cast members finally turned it off. The next morning, though, the cast members went to work to find the lamp on. The lamp was turned on by itself, mysteriously. The lamp was never turned off and never went out. The lamp now holds Walt Disney's spirit and is a cherished part of the Disney family. Now, this is meant as a cute story and it's portrayed as such, but they didn't go into detail there on how this was actually discovered. Apparently, a Disney employee was there the night before and was responsible for turning the light off. They did such and was walking out of the room when the light turned back on. They got a little frightened but went to turn the light off again, and sure enough, before they could leave the room, boom, light's back on. Now they are really freaking out and have to call a bunch of people in to see what the heck was happening. Eventually they just chalked it up as Walt Disney's ghost coming back, but that's also like really scary too. I'm kind of surprised that we're just all okay with having Walt Disney's ghost just chilling in a lamp at a fire depot, like just overseeing everything. I mean, mean, I guess if they're cool with having his head in a freezer like people talk about, then a little ghostly lamp action really isn't that big of a deal either. Number 3 on this list is Boblo Island. I had to include Boblo Island on this list to give a bit of a shout out to Ontario, where your boy grew up. Boblo Island was wildly successful for a time and operated for nearly a century. As with a lot of places on this list though, it couldn't seem to power through the 90s and had to shut down. Reader's Digest says, picture an 1898 Victorian amusement park, music from an organ grinder, women's skirts swishing around the dance hall, children's laughter echoing from various newfangled rides. That's what this theme park on Boys Blank Island, nicknamed Boblo, near Detroit on the Canadian side of the Detroit River, was to residents alike. Its doors were shut nearly 100 years later in 1993, and the area is now closed to the public. But you can boat or kayak by the remains, listening for the ghostly sounds of long past visitors. While you can't stay here overnight, you can rent these 8 haunted places on Airbnb. Being on an island really adds to the creepiness for me, I think. Like this place, from all the pictures I could find, it really looks totally detached from all other society. Basically meaning that whatever happens here, you are totally by yourself. Like there is a new set of rules for this island. There have been stories that something lurks here. A spirit or something dark. Be very careful if you ever go to Boblo Island. Number 2 on this list is Pripyat Amusement Park. Pripyat is a town that we've talked a lot about on this channel already. In fact, it was recently featured in a video where we looked at the top 5 mysterious towns that are completely abandoned. Pripyat is a ghost town in northern Ukraine and near the Ukrainian and Belarus border. It was named after the nearby river Pripyat and was founded in 1970. Right in the town is a small amusement park that once looked quite fun and had plans to grow into a big Ukrainian park that people might flock to. Those dreams were never realized though, and now it sits in complete and utter disarray. Those dreams were never realized because of the horrible accident that occurred in 1986. You see, the town of Pripyat was basically established to serve the Chernobyl nuclear power plant. When it was first built, it was a closed town basically only for the workers of this place, but it grew and grew as time went on, and at its height had a population of just under 50,000 people. I don't need to go into too much detail about the accident as a whole, because I imagine that you guys are all pretty aware. But basically, this was the worst accident of this nature in human history, and for all our sakes, we need to hope that it never happens again. The radiation damage was absolutely massive, and right after it happened, the entire town of Pripyat had to be evacuated. That, of course, has left the amusement park, right in the middle of this town, completely abandoned as well. Not a lot of people have gone to this town or park since this incident occurred. For a long time, it wasn't safe to set foot within a set radius of the blast. Those who have been brave or foolish enough to set foot into this town and explore the amusement park have reported some strange and scary findings. Rumor has it that some sort of entity lives there. Something dark and evil calling this abandoned place home. A nasty and sinister entity that doesn't like to be disturbed. There have been talks of this being some type of shadow creature or potentially a beast, like a werewolf of sorts. Either way, the people who visit this place feel an overwhelming sense of dread when they're there. They also feel as if they're unwelcome, like they entered somebody's home who doesn't want them there. There are multiple reasons why this amusement park is abandoned, so I'd stay away if I was you. And finally, number 1 on this list is Six Flags. Now, I don't mean Six Flags as a chain or anything like that. There's 23 different Six Flags in the United States, and not all of them are haunted. One in particular, though, is currently out of commission, abandoned, and definitely a spot you shouldn't go to. All the Rooms writes, this Six Flags fell out of business following serious damage from Hurricane Katrina in 2005. The park opened in 2000 and was only operating for a few years before suffering significantly during the hurricane, which displaced 20,000 people and killed nearly 2,000 people. The park closed after Hurricane Katrina, and there wasn't enough funding for repair, so it fell into further decay over the last few years. To this day, there's still an eerie sign at the entrance of the park that says closed for the storm. It's an apocalyptic site which has been taken advantage of by Hollywood and used for films such as Jurassic World and Dawn of Planet of the Apes. These filmmakers are way braver than I would be, because I would not want to be setting foot on those grounds. The people who have been here all seem to think that something paranormal is going on. Phantom noises echoing through throughout the park and other random bodiless sounds are heard all the time. Similarly to a lot of the other things on this list, there is a massive overhanging feeling of dread. The air is thick with it and you can almost taste the discomfort. No one has reported being attacked here, but it seems like that's only a matter of time if people keep going. The mayor of New Orleans is currently looking at demolishing this park, which, in my opinion, probably for the best.
Number 5, the Warner Brothers Jungle Habitat. Originally opening on July 19th of 1972, this park closed its doors by 1976, which is a really bad timeline for a theme park that was technically never completed. The first time Jungle Habitat made headlines was only months after it first opened for business, when an Israeli tourist named Abraham Levy was riding through the safari in a taxi cab and decided to roll down the window to get a better look at some of the animals roaming about. Two lions attacked the car and mauled the 26-year-old tourist, causing lacerations to his face and shoulder. He took credit for the harm, citing his own foolishness, which helped to dodge a media onslaught. Well, for the most part. By the end of the year, reports of animals escaping into the wilds of West Milford were far too many in volume to be ignored. Besides sightings of harmless animals like peacocks, there were rumors spreading about dangerous animals such as a pack of wolves and a lion being sighted along local roads. These sentiments, voiced 28 years ago, are identical to the rumors still running rampant today. Yep, you heard me. Today. Tales told by West Milford residents who have looked out in their backyards include wandering ostriches and a band of baboons running amok in the town's pharmacy. Emus, baboons, and even wolves are just some of the uncaged critters which were known to have escaped the park. I feel like I found the origins for the Night at the Museum franchise. On July 8th of 1974, a 68-year-old visitor from Long Island was grabbed by the trunk of a baby elephant, which then slammed her against a fence and bit her. The woman, Elizabeth Ennis, was later awarded $200,000 by a court. In an account in the New York Times, she claimed the elephant bit her on her right hand, and because of the trauma incurred by being slammed into the fence, she had persistent pain in her right side that prevented her from lifting heavy items. Her husband was awarded $5,000 for loss of companionship. So the animals at the park also had a tendency to damage the cars that passed through. An e-museum for the park says that tigers like to bite and pop car tires, and monkeys like to rip antennas off of cars. Sounds like a lack of good animal training and boundaries to me. So right after the park closed in 1976, some animal carcasses were left outside. This pile grew until 30 animal bodies, including that of an elephant, a bison, a camel, some zebras, were all left lying until April, when the ground had thawed enough to finally bury what was left of the bodies. The 6 months that they were left exposed was a violation of state laws, which stated that any animal should be buried within 48 hours of its death. Despite this violation, Warner Brothers was not sanctioned. Jungle Habitat is gone now, but not forgotten. Reports of mysterious kangaroo sightings in remote corners of West Milford still turn up from time to time. Number 4, Under the Sea Gone Wrong. Disney's River Country was the first water park at Walt Disney World, and possibly the first themed water park ever. Look, as much as I love Disney World, and I'm mentally planning my next trip back, I'm here to call a spade a spade. Some consider River Country to be the first water park anywhere, but that depends on how you define a water park. Yes, River Country opened almost a year before Wet n Wild in Orlando, but there were public pools and lake parks with water slides and other aquatic play equipment long before River Country opened. So just as Disneyland had reinvented the amusement park 21 years earlier, River Country reinvented aquatic recreation. The water park's grand opening was on June 20th of 1976, and on Thursday, August 28th of 1980, a sad Associated Press story appeared in newspapers throughout North America. It was reported that a rare but deadly disease caused by an amoeba found in Florida freshwater lakes had claimed its fourth victim, a New York youngster who had spent his vacation swimming at River Country. The disease, amoebic meningoencephalitis, attacked the nervous system and brain. You don't want to know how many tries it took me to say that. The youngster died after the amoeba entered his nose, went through the nasal passage, and attacked the nervous system, including the brain. Investigators from the U.S. Center for Disease Control in Atlanta and the New York Health Department pinpointed River Country as the source of the amoeba after the parents reported that the amusement park was the only place where he went swimming. So photos and maps of River Country show that the park had two bodies of water. The smaller one was a clean, clear swimming pool. The larger one appeared to be a natural cove, completely open to Bay Lake, which is the largest natural lake at Walt Disney World. At some point in the 1990s, Walt Disney World banned swimming in its lake. The 1995 map of Walt Disney World still included the resort's beaches under the swimming section, whereas the 2000 edition made it clear that the beaches were strictly for sunbathing. But River Country stayed open. There was never another death from amoebic, very long word that I'm not going to try and say again, linked to River Country. But there were two drownings, one in 1982 and the other in 1989. So River Country had its normal seasonal closing at the end of the 2001 season, but when the time came for it to reopen for the 2002 season, it didn't. Favorite country never reopened.
Number 3 on this list is the Haunted Mansion. Alright, so there are actually tons of different legends surrounding the Haunted Mansion, so I wanted to lump them all into one entry here. All Ears says there are two versions of this story, one involving a construction worker and the other involving a test rider. While the specifics are slightly different, the overall gist of the tale is the same, that the original version of the Haunted Mansion was so terrifying that it led to someone suffering a heart attack and dying. According to the myth, this led to an extensive retooling of the ride, adding in a humorous tone and delaying the mansion's opening from the early 1960s to 1969. This was the first of many legends surrounding this ride and still is brought up all the time. It's hard to forget that it ever happened because apparently employees of Disneyland today have seen the ghost of this person tons of times. Another legend in this haunted mansion centers around Madame Leota's spellbook. Many Disney employees have come out and talked about how they get a bad feeling whenever they pass by the spellbook in the ride or have to do anything with it. Apparently, this spellbook is actually an authentic spellbook from the 1400s. It was used by a witch and was responsible for a lot of death and evil taking place. So already we have a ton of scary and dark stuff going on here, but what really doesn't help the situation is when people take the ashes of their dead and spread them. Yeah, this literally happens, guys. Andrew379, a former employee, says it's pretty common for guests to dump ashes of their loved ones on the Haunted Mansion ride. They do it because there are 999 ghosts and there's always room for 1,000. This has obviously left a bit of a ghostly presence at this place, and Disney employees are not too fond of it. One story had a Disney employee run for their life because they were being chased by a whole mob of ghosts, presumably spirits of those who have had their ashes dumped here. There are even more scary legends that workers have told about this mansion too, so moral of the story, probably best to stay away. Number 2 on this list is The Jump. Disneyland has some big hotels on its ground. These hotels have balconies. If someone got the idea that they wanted to take their own life, then it wouldn't be too hard for them to do it from said Disneyland hotel balcony. That's exactly what happened back in 2008. Reuters says a man apparently jumped to his death on Friday from the 14th floor of the Disneyland hotel at the world famous amusement park in Southern California, police said. The man, who was in town on business and not immediately identified by authorities, was killed in the 14 story fall from his hotel room balcony. He was pronounced dead at the scene. Right now, it's certainly looking like a suicide, Anaheim Police Sergeant Rick Martinez told Reuters. He was seen leaping off the balcony. Martinez said the man, who was in Anaheim on business and appears to be in his 30s or 40s, also left evidence in the room that suggested it was that. He was sharing a room with another male associate, and for some reason he went out onto the balcony, and all indications are that it was an intentional act, Martinez said. The Disneyland Hotel has nearly 1,000 rooms in 3 towers overlooking the so-called happiest place on earth. Some employees of this hotel saw this happen firsthand and were the first ones to see his body at the ground. It obviously wasn't a pretty sight, having just fallen from 14 stories up. I don't know about you guys, but if I was the one to have seen that firsthand and found him, I truly believe that I'd be scarred for life. That is literally a life-altering thing that you just witnessed and probably won't ever be the same again. And number 1 on this list is mind control. Hold up, Disneyland is using mind control on people? Well, sort of. Screen Rant says, Disney has been suspected of some pretty far out things, but mind control? Surely not. The reality of this suggestion is a little bit more plausible than one might first think. Some call it mind control, but Disney calls it immersion. Forced perspective and other visual tricks are common, but it's the smellitzers that truly sell the illusion. These little devices pump the parks full of smells appropriate to their placed environments and can smell like anything from popcorn to pirate water. A secret yet surprisingly effective way to keep guests entranced. Employees working here regularly have even caught themselves consistently getting fooled by these little tricks the park plays on our minds. It's not illegal what they're doing, but it's definitely pretty shady. Really pulls the curtain back on the whole operation that is Disneyland. The most magical place on earth is really nothing more than just a bunch of smoke and mirrors and really nice smells.